keep an eye out and see if they haven't crossed the road. They came into the drainage here and apparently were heading this way. But I don't got no sign of them now. You've got them. Ha! Well done, David. Wild dogs, everybody. Where are they going, Dave? Let's keep going. They're still in, did they go in there? Oh, you can still see them there. Well done. Oh, there's a whole pack there in the grass. They look like they might be eating something. Brilliant stuff. Sturgeon's relocated this pack on the eastern side of the drainage line as it crosses the power lines. It's just killed. We have hit a very large stump. They've just killed everyone. Oh, this is fantastic. I suspect a Nyala or bushbuck copped it. Ha! Look at that. There they are. They don't have traps. Very quiet. And as I was saying, cat egalitarian eating. Nobody's fighting over food. Everyone's taken their share off. That looked like a fairly big bone. Let's move slightly closer in. Very helpful if Rusty wouldn't rev quite so high every time we start her. Dee, I'm going to have to ask for your question again. We're just going to quickly see what's going on here. Yeah, I think it's a Nyala. It is a Nyala. Ah, V, you're wondering if they're the same as dingoes or coyotes. They're not the same as dingoes. Or coyotes. Coyotes are much more like jackals. They're part of the same family. They're all the dog family. But wild dogs are in a genus all of their own, which means they cannot interbreed with things like wolves, domestic dogs, coyotes, or indeed dingoes. And most of those belong to the genus Canis, which is the most common dog genus. Listen to it. And these ones belong to the genus Lycaon. Right. Oh, seems to be a bit of mating behavior going on there. It's probably two youngsters. Now, Siberia Zumi, I'm afraid I cannot answer this question. You say to me, oh, is this the Investec pack? I have lost track of who's who and how and where. I don't know, I'm afraid. It's been so long since I saw the pack this size that I'm not sure which pack it is. Not even sure how many we have here. And of course, it's quite difficult to tell with them all knocking about the place, running like they are. But there are a lot of youngsters. I can't see, I don't think, more than three adults or so. Here's an adult coming to the left on the left. Oh, hello. I don't think you should climb onto the car. David, I think that dog wants to give you a piece of its breakfast. Wouldn't that be nice? Would you like a piece of Nyala for breakfast? Hello, little wild dog. Now going back around the side. I was saying that everybody shares and they get their share. Well, they do normally. But they do, once the carcass has been torn apart, there is an element of sort of thievery that goes along. But it seems to be much more good-natured than it is, for example, with lions. After a tremendously quiet morning, this is a brilliant way to kind of come to the climax. Ali, you have asked the same question that Red Riding Hood asked of the Big Bad Wolf. And the answer that the Big Bad Wolf gave to Red Riding Hood is the same. You said, why do wild dogs have such big ears? Well, the answer, Ali, is all the better to hear you with, my dear. The reason they have such big ears is because they use them tremendously to communicate with each other, especially when they're on the hunt. They use sound. And they must have their big ears to, they use them like satellite dishes, and they pick up the whooping calls that they make when they're on the hunt, and then the chittering and chattering when they do actually kill something. And you know, I think it's given us a huge amount of insight following these dogs on the hunt, following them on the hunt with the drone as opposed to the vehicle, which has allowed us to see that, like that latest research has showed, their hunting is much more random than we ever thought it was before. And those ears, when they bombshell in 100 different directions trying to catch things, play a massively important role in finding each other. And I think, and I'm sort of slightly ashamed to say this, that I think we've made it at times very difficult for them to find each other and follow each other during the hunt because of the vehicles moving behind them. Because their behavior, while we were watching them with the drone, I think was relatively different. You know, they didn't seem to lose each other quite as readily as when we were following them in the cars. This is just brilliant, isn't it wonderful? Of course, dreadful behavior to play with your food like that. Enough. Still trying to share with David, but David is not interested in taking any food from them. Akib, you want to know how long ago I think they made this kill? I don't think more than 15 minutes ago. I think they lost them coming into the drainage line, I mean the other game drives. They found a Nyala, flushed it, killed it, and within the last 15 minutes they've torn it to pieces and they're now enjoying the spoils of their kill. Wonderful stuff. And things will now settle quite nicely, I think. V, you say, how fast do I think they will devour this prey? Well, I think they're pretty much done, and I think it's probably taken them about 15 minutes or so. They'll eat the last bones and that sort of thing for the next little while, but otherwise, it's pretty much done, V. They eat very fast. They bolt their food very quickly. This is fantastic. How lucky we are. And it doesn't seem that anybody else wants to come to the sighting, so we won't complain about that at all. We'll be more than happy to have it ourselves. Enjoy the cavorting around that they are engaging in. David, just next to us, of course, is your friend who was trying to share with you, but you didn't want to share with him. Not sure why you were so churlish about that. Just one or two monotonous larks still calling in the background. Otherwise all is rather gorgeous piece for it, Monsieur. They're having a great time in front of us now. I imagine, David, filming a wild dog sighting is a little bit like being asked to film butterflies.
A little more tricky.
They don't sit still for very long. Christina, you want to know if they bark. They don't bark like your garden variety Fido, no. But they do make an alarm bark, which I'm not going to imitate now because that might give them a bit of a fright. But it's sort of loud, and they do it once, so they'll get up and they'll go quite loudly. That's the only barking that they do. When they're communicating with each other, though, there's no barking. It's much more twittering, that sort of twittering sound that you can hear them making now. They do a lot of. Isn't this brilliant? And you can see, I mean, immediately, because they are so active, they're always entertaining to watch. You never find yourself in a situation like you do often with lions, where you wonder if they're actually going to do anything other than lie around. And I don't know, every so often you might just be able to hear them making that kind of woofing sound. Justin, you want to know one of my best wild dog sightings? Well, that's a very easy question to answer. It was a sighting we had on foot here when Scott was following the dogs down the road and Andrew and I were on bushwalk, and we just happened, our paths happened to coincide. We sort of thought, guessed where the dogs might go, and we went and sat on the road, and they came right past us, Andrew, and the adults looked at us and just carried on going, and then the pups stopped, and they stopped about 2 meters from us and just stopped to look and investigate. One went round the side to smell. I never felt any sense of threat, just a sense of real sort of honor. And it's that, I mean, I do bang on about this, but it's that sort of rare touch that you have with the wilderness, where something completely wild has chosen to come into your space, and it gives you a very rare kind of, a very rare and very strong connection with something so wild, with the wilderness. And so that was definitely the most special wild dog sighting I ever had, even though it only lasted probably less than a minute. Very special indeed that was. Wild dogs on foot are always special, and in fact one of the first big game sightings I ever had on foot was with wild dogs. And April, you say this is your first time seeing the wild dogs live. That's fantastic, April. I'm glad. I hope you're enjoying it as much as I am. You can see I'm shooting the odd photograph, trying to take a little bit of video, but it's impossible, of course, because these dogs are moving around at such a speed. So I'll probably delete all 7,000 that I've taken so far. You just feel things starting to settle slightly. Pups love to play. Oh, Nicholas, you say, do they have a hierarchy? Absolutely they do, Nicholas. They live exactly like a wolf pack does. There's an alpha male and an alpha female. They kind of run the pack. They're the only two to breed normally, although sometimes a beta female does give birth. And the rest of them fall into a very strict hierarchy, and there's a definite omega dog, and that hierarchy is sorted not too long after birth. And eventually when they disperse, between 1 and 2 years often, the males will go off together and the females will go off together. They will probably maintain the hierarchy that they've had from birth. And that's set up by playing. Who knows? It's so interesting, you know, it's very interesting actually to watch the same sort of thing happening with human children. Who knows what creates it or what, you know, what decides the hierarchy? Is it purely strength? Is it when you were born first? Is it some kind of random genetic predisposition to fighting, to being more aggressive? Who knows? It's always interesting to try and understand how the hierarchy forms and who fits in as an alpha and who fits in as an omega, because they all, of course, belong to the same parents. So unlike in the human society, for example, where... In human society where, you know, kids will often take on the dominance that their parents feel. That doesn't happen with these dogs because they come from the same parents. And much like a hyena clan, where also the youngsters will take their social status from their mother. It just doesn't happen here because their mothers, of course, they all have the same mother for all of the pups. So somehow there's it's either chance or there's some genetic condition or genetic predisposition to being the alpha or the omega. Christina, you say, where are their babies? We're looking at their babies, Christina. We're looking at last year's babies, largely. Most of these dogs here are juveniles, or just about yearlings. They'll be just under a year old. And the alpha pair could well be in the process of mating or have mated already. And they will be looking to sort of raise the next generation come the winter time. So these are the youngsters. There won't be any youngsters in a den now. And these youngsters have probably just started becoming particularly useful to hunting. And one of the main reasons I say that, of course, is that we have here, they've killed a pretty, what looks to me like an adult Nyala cow. I mean, it's difficult to say from the little pieces that we've seen, but the one leg looked pretty large. And that would be difficult if this is, I think there are probably only three or four adults in this pack. And so, you know, a big Nyala adult, not that easy for them to have killed. So I'm sure these youngsters are making a contribution now. Pug fanatic, you want to know how big the wild dog litters get, and one cannot help but say larger than the pug's litters probably. I've seen litters, I've heard of litters of up to 24 pups, which is obviously enormous, but it's not completely impossible. 18 would be large, somewhere around 12 to 16 would probably be the norm. I'll actually check for you if you like. I can check exactly what the average is for the Kruger region on my spanky new mammal app. I'll look it under D for dog, shall I, David?
Yes.
Yes, good. Let's have a look. Distribution, we want mating habits. Of course, this is not set out very nicely. 7+1, 6 radium. And Michael, you want to know what determines when they disperse from the pack, which is just age, and eventually they hit puberty and they decide that they need to go and sort of leave home and set up life on their own. And mean pack size in the Kruger Park is 13 and a half animals plus minus 7, so I mean it is a massive variation there. It's almost impossible to say what the mean is. It doesn't actually give a it gives a mean size for the... Here we go. I'll get onto the dispersal now. Yeah, so they become sexually mature at just under 2 years, and round about then they'll move off. Now I'm just checking in here. Average litter size was 8, interestingly, in the Kruger. 8 plus 2, plus minus 2. I've seldom seen a litter size that small. So, I mean, that's obviously done taken from quite a lot of research, but I'm not sure how modern it is. So, yeah, it says 8 here, so maybe it's as much as 10 as the average. I don't think that'll be very average. Well, look at the injury. That's a horrible, horrible injury there. Ooh. Dog has been mangled. Look at the ears as well. That's not a youngster. Look at him. Or her. It's a male. Now, R. Lara Moore, you say, could that be from another wild dog? I don't think so, no. I think that's from something like a lion or a leopard. It may be an injury from hunting. That is an old dog. I'm not sure I've ever seen a dog that old before. Ears mangled. It may even be a skin disease, you know. I don't think so, though. I think that's a piece of skin that's been torn off. Very, very skinny, very skinny back. And losing muscle there. Okay, Byron, while I try and unfold the mysteries here, has managed to find a bird that he can't identify.